Welcome back, everyone. I am Scribe D, and this is Bayonetta. In the last episode, we finished Chapter 3, and now we get to our first major boss level, like our first Auditio fight. And this one is going to be against someone we've seen in all three chapters, aside from the prologue, of course. Fortitudo, the cardinal virtue of fortitude.
You again? And here I thought I'd seen the last of you. I'm sure you'll be more than hospitable to me this time around. I'm sorry. I forgot to mention one of the reasons I hunt your kind. You're much too ugly not to put out of your misery. Flock off, featherface.
Okay, so the shitty thing about not being able to talk over cutscenes is there's so much to talk about. Okay, gotta keep everything straight. So like I said previously, this is the Colosseum that you can see at the end of Chapter 2 and mentioned in Antonio's notebook. And I guess I should explain why I'm glowing yellow. So there's a trick that I might have alluded to earlier, but I haven't really shown off or talked about at least. So basically, when you're in a cutscene that directly precedes combat and Bayonetta has a lollipop, you can press one of the face buttons to get the effect of the corresponding lollipop. I think it has to be before the lollipop comes out of her mouth again. X or A on the 360 is the green health lollipop. Circle or B is the red one that increases your damage. Square or X on the 360 is the magic one, and the one I'm using is Y, which is the yellow moon, if that makes me invulnerable for a little bit. And the cool thing about this is this trick doesn't count as an item used in the rating screen at the end. Also, all my attacks right now are wicked weebs for the duration of this boss fight, because I'm in something called serious mode, which you get because the devs thought it looked odd having little tiny Bayonetta have such a big impact on these mega-sized enemies, the Auditio. So they give them really huge health pools and make your attacks all wicked weaves. And there's an accessory you can get called the Climax Brace that puts you into serious mode all the time, but it has two caveats. One, your records aren't recorded when you use it because that would be a little broken. And two, you have to have all 101 Umbran Tears of Blood, which means collecting all the crows I talked about, I think, in Episode 2. And you also have to do a non-stop Infinite Climax playthrough to get the rest of them. So, in the beginning cutscene here, Fortitudo may or may not have been talking to a certain recurring disembodied voice who, for the sake of spoilers, shall go unnamed for the time being. Here we see that, that mechanic from Chapter 3, the hourglass thing, getting brought back a little bit, so we can get up on the platform and away from the scary-ass lava. And they put Fortitudo just a little bit out of reach, so sometimes, most of the times really, it's better to fight him down here. Just wait for him to destroy the columns where you'll get the hourglass or some other stuff. Eventually, the lava does clear out. Ooh, he gave me an opening. So, that's awfully nice of him. Yeah, and you can see his health bar starts out, I think it was blue. You deplete it once, becomes green. You deplete it again, it goes back to the normal yellow. So he essentially has three health bars. and the fight changes slightly as time progresses. Let's see what else. The lion Bayonetta says right before the fight begins, flock off, Featherface. It's an homage to Devil May Cry. I think it's when Dante is talking to Griffin. And that's not the first Devil May Cry reference, and it definitely won't be the last. Let's see, speaking of other games that Hideki Kamiya has played a major role in the creation of, Okami. This one isn't so much about Kamiya himself and just more of a 6 degrees of Hideki. That was a really bad joke. The person who animated Yami, the last boss of Okami, did the animations for Fortitudo here. I think his name is Aijiro. And you can see some similarity here between Fortitudo and one of Yami's later forms. Also, I think Aijiro is the same person who did the animations for the enchants and maybe the, what were they called? I think the shadows from Devil May Cry? Actually, a decent amount of the animations here. Those are just the two that pop into mind. At least from the commentary. Because, of course, I wouldn't know a little bit of developer trivia like that if not for Hideki Kamiya's developer commentary. So it's probably time for me to shout out that huge source of interesting trivia again. Because honestly, without the legwork that people like Hideki Kamiya have put into doing that kind of developer commentary, that very lengthy one that's still ongoing, I would not have all these cool things to share with you guys. That, and of course the Bayonetta wiki, the guys over at Xbox 360 achievements, and PS3 trophies, NeoGAF, GameFAQs, a whole bunch of other places have put together all sorts of compendiums of cool trivia and explanations for why things work the way they do, all sorts of good resources to read. And of course, there's a long, long list of scholarly essays people have written about the game, about the combat, the design of it, and of course, the overtones of gender politics in this game, which I think there's a really good talking point to be made in either chapter 6 or 7, so that is a discussion that'll get brought back up again soon enough. But yeah, I just want to thank everybody who has talked about this wonderful, wonderful game and contributed so much to my knowledge of it. So, so cool. I think this should enter us into the final phase of this fight. If I wanted to be a little more reckless, I could have gotten closer to him and probably done a little bit more damage before we start this phase of the fight. And now, kind of like a Mega Man boss, he goes into a desperation mode at low health. So, since thinking about the developer commentary reminded me of this, Bayonetta used to have a mechanic where if you depleted all of your magic, you would turn into a teenage version of Bayonetta, with a ponytail and a higher-pitched voice. And the changes to the magic gauge, which functioned a little more like a stamina bar in most typical action games, that, you know, they rapidly fill up, but they also deplete pretty quickly, that's pretty much that change to the magic gauge is pretty much the only thing that stopped that mechanic from being in the game, and it's probably better off for that. You can see this fight's not too much of a problem. The end here, he can output a lot of damage. Usually when I play Fortitude, I end up just getting messed up by the lava on the floor, but Okay, so hopefully you can hear this. And I want to explain this now because there's a cutscene right after this. And then the level ends. If you listen carefully during Malphus's animation sequence, Malphus, by the way, is the giant hair crow, our second infernal demon. You can hear this really out of place sound effect, this big thundering stomp kind of effect. That is the heavy thud of Fortitudo's footsteps being played over Malphus's introduction sound effects. And they did it because they wanted to make his introduction more impressive, and they didn't have time towards the end of development to add in any new sound files or new data.
You know, you're not nearly so ugly when you're screaming. Foretold? Explain yourself.
Okay, so that was Fortitudo, and we have our mysterious disembodied voice repeating his line from Chapter 1 when Bayonetta's stepping off the train going into Vigrid. And we're getting the plot, the main plot anyway, into high gear now that Fortitudo dropped that little hint that he is working with the mysterious voice to resurrect the creator Jubileus, who is the top of the top on the hierarchy of Laguna. Pretty much the god of this world. And concentrate. Fucking hit a bird. Yeah, it was okay. There's this weird kind of inertia here that I'm kind of not used to for a shooter. Just making up excuses for why I suck so bad at this. Okay. Always amused at my failings. So, that's going to do it for the cardinal virtue of fortitude. And I believe that's it. I don't think there's anything too important happening on the board. Just going to take us into our introduction for Chapter 5. But, I don't really feel like starting up Chapter 5 tonight. It's been a long recording night. So, gonna end this episode on the rather short little boss fight, but we'll pick up with lots and lots more content in the coming days. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.
Another LP.
Oh yeah, this other LP.
Working me to the bone.
Then we'll
no
cut.
I was bored anyways. Let me go whip some things into shape for you.
Yes, indeed. Rodan is going to whip something up for us, or whip something into shape for us. I wonder what that will be.
It was a close one this time. This bad boy might even be hard for you to get a handle on. Take care of yourself.
And this is our whip. It's probably not going to be used too much. I know one specific Alfheim challenge where it's going to be really handy, and then not too many other places after that. Anyway, like I was saying before, take it easy. Have a good one, everyone. Make sure to rate, comment, subscribe, share this with your friends, everything. Do all the things on the YouTubes. Bye!